Even 66 years after independence, the place of Muslims in India is still a vexed and fractious conversation, cynically capitalized on by both the Hindu right and the secular left. Much of the friction around this question arises out of the controversial way in which the history of the religion in the subcontinent is told. Was it a monolithic, barbaric, proselytizing military force that destroyed temples, converted Hindus forcibly, and left Hindus with a perennial and crippled sense of self? Or was it a series of complex and plural interactions through which it both changed the subcontinent and was changed by it? How can contemporary Muslims free themselves from the imprisonment of this dialogue over history and argument over history and take their rightful place as equal citizens in a modern nation? To engage with these questions, we have two absolutely fascinating speakers today. But at first, I'm going to call up Richard Eaton, one of the foremost scholars of Islam in India, in the entire world. He took a train from Iran to India in the 1960s, and his relationship has continued since then. His scholarship has completely changed the terms of the debate. He argues that both religious conversion and temple destruction were political acts rather than acts of religious purity and chauvinism. He's written books on the Sufis of Bijapur, on the growth of Islam in Bengal, and he has a fascinating argument about how a true perspective on history will come if we look at a dialogue between two literary cultures of Persian and Sanskrit rather than Islam and Hinduism or through any religious prism. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Richard Eaton. So Richard, yes. You know, you, as I said, you really changed the terms of the debate of medieval history. Most of all, you've also been examining why Aurangzeb does not need to be the kind of hot political potato that he is. But today, I'd like to focus on two things, which are really the heart of the kind of animosity that Muslims face in India. And first of all is this idea of temple destruction. According to the Hindu right, Muslim rulers and invaders destroyed almost 60,000 temples in India. Is this true? Is that what you found in your scholarship? And you know, how are we supposed to read the presence of Islam in India and what it did to the indigenous Hindu culture?
Yes, thank you. Well, the question of temple destruction or temple desecration is something that occurred to me as a vitally important question for historians to examine in the wake of the Babri Masjid destruction in 1992. That's when I became aware of the need for historians to look seriously and carefully at the back history of the relationship between politics, between religion, and between historical monuments. And the monuments, of course, is the central issue in this case. And so, yes, I decided I would undertake the task of looking at exactly what is the evidence, what can we say looking at the original Persian inscriptions, Arabic inscriptions, respecting the history of these monuments. What the original documents had to say, the Persian chronicles. And I made an effort, therefore, to look at the pattern and see what kinds of configurations might emerge at the history of monuments in India. And what I discovered in trying to ask the question, when were temples destroyed, why were they destroyed, by whom were they destroyed, and in what context, I discovered that there were approximately 80.
So 500 years.
In over about a period of 800 years. And it's fascinating when you look at the map and see how this moves. What was happening was the temples that were destroyed were those, it was not random. It was only those that were associated with royalty that had been defeated. And so as the movement of Turkish arms proceeds from Punjab down to the Bengal Delta and then into the Deccan Plateau. There's a moving frontier. And it's only those temples that were associated with earlier power that were desecrated. All other temples were left alone. And that's one of the important points. The second important point was that there was a prior history of temple desecration that had been taken, that had occurred over the previous 500 years by Hindu rulers against other Hindu rulers or Buddhist rulers, dating back to about the 8th or 9th century. So I realized that I needed to actually extend this further than the 12th century when the first Turks appear and look at the background of this. And what I discovered was, actually, there's textual references for the, if you read the Manosalasa, a Sanskrit text of Shomashwara II of the Kalyana Chalukya Empire, he recommends that when a king conquers another kingdom, it is necessary to destroy the temple of that enemy kingdom. That's exactly what happened. Across South Asia, we see this pattern continuing. So essentially, the Turks were following a custom that was already laid in place by earlier rulers over the previous 500 years.
So in essence, what you're saying is that they were humiliating sites of political power, not religious association.
Precisely.
And you know, can you give us a couple of really startling examples? You just mentioned about Someshwara, but others where, you know, I was reading your book on Islam in India, where the Chalukyas and Pratiharas and, you know, where they've actually taken idols from different places and installed it in their own palaces rather than even in a temple. So can you just share a couple of startling examples of Hindu desecration of Hindu temples?
Yes, I mean, there's, well, the Cholas, you mentioned the Chalukyas, in the Deccan Plateau, the Cholas in particular were in the habit of seizing objects of veneration from other temples and bringing them down into the Tamil country as that power expanded. They took artifacts from the Chalukya temples when they seized Kalyana in the early 12th century, and we find the same thing occurring in North India as well. So I guess the point is that there is a very important tradition, an attitude toward the political importance of temples, not all temples, but only those temples that were identified with royal power, that one has to understand before beginning to take on the 12th century period and forward.
So it's nowhere close to the 60,000 temples that the Hindutva speaks
that's
of.
Absolutely. Impossible to sustain that. There's no evidence for that.
Okay. Richard, I'd like to then come to the other question, which again, as I said, is at the fractious heart of contemporary conversations on Muslims, which is the issue of conversions.
Yes.
Again, you have an extremely radical thesis, which is that neither was it an act of by the sword, nor was it a movement towards gaining social equality.
Right.
And so it wasn't even an act of liberating the lower castes. But that conversion actually happened through the plow, and that there's a kind of geographic perplexity almost about the areas in which Hindus converted to Islam. So could you share that with us?
One of the difficulties that we have, not just scholars, but all the public, is the terms by which we theorize reality. You use the word conversion. That is actually the wrong word, I think, to describe what is happening as we look in the past of Indian history. Conversion means to turn over, and it connotes a rather sudden conversion. Last night, I was listening to one of the songs that was sung over the dinner outside, and it was Amazing Grace. How sweet the song that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now can see. Now that is a 19th century Protestant hymn, which signals to us a Protestant model of religious change, which is sudden and which is complete. It's a conversion that turns over instantly. When I read Indian history, I don't see evidence of such a sudden change occurring, that people suddenly had a kind of awareness of was lost but now can see, that the past is completely thrown out and something new has suddenly come in. What actually seems to be occurring, as I look at the evidence, is a gradual assimilation of different ideas which are brought into the existing body of values and rituals and ideas that were already there. Another problem that we have, apart from the word conversion, is this model that religion is something that starts in a center and then diffuses to the periphery. I call this the peanut butter approach, where kind of the spread of religion, we start here and we end up there. What we really need to see is to turn the thing exactly around and see from the perspective of the receiver how outside ideas are gradually filtered in, rather than simply ideas that are imposed from the outside to the periphery. Now, when you take those kinds of ideas and you think about something as emotional as religion, it seems to me that we can arrive at a new and a fresh way of understanding religious change. The other thing I would say is that when you look at the map of South Asia, the most dramatic conversion that occurred was not in the heartland of where Muslim rule was most prevalent, which is the Delhi Doab, but rather on the far periphery. And one of the reasons for that is that it is in the periphery that was at that time, which means the 15th to 16th century, the least penetrated by Brahminical ideas of society and culture, whereas the Aryavarta, the heartland, was already very Hindu. So it was only on the periphery, in what became Bangladesh and Sindh and Western Punjab, where these ideas were taking off. When I worked on Bengal, the first question that kind of came to my mind is, why is it that the East Bengal becomes predominantly Muslim, but not the West? And what I discovered was that it was East Bengal was an area that had not already been influenced by Hindu values. That's number one. And number two, this was an area that was not yet brought under the plow.
When you say that the East Bengal was not imbued by Hindu values, what do you mean? That they were tribals or they were...
Who were these people? There were tribals. They subscribed to various animistic forms of religion that were not yet influenced by Brahminical understanding of caste and of piety. And the change that occurs in the 16th century is that pioneers come in, sponsored by the Mughal government, not to convert anybody, but rather to reduce the land to the plow. The Mughal government, after all, is interested primarily in loyalty and in revenue. So what they're trying to do is to expand the area of cultivation, which means you cut the forest. East Bengal was much more thickly wooded than West Bengal. You cut the forest and you expand the area of cultivation. And the pioneers who were cutting the forest were also required, as a condition of their obtaining land, they were required to build either a temple or a mosque. If the pioneer were a Hindu, it would be a temple. And subsequently, that area would be a Hindu area. If the pioneer were a Muslim, he would build a mosque. Because most of the pioneers happened to be Muslims, most of the jungle that was cut was cut by tribal elements who had been organized by Muslim pioneers. Now, when I say a mosque, I don't mean some grand, spectacular marble or brick monument. I'm talking about a very humble thatch, bamboo structure. But it became the nucleus of a new society organized around
agricultural society.
Yeah, exactly. So that Islam, what we really see, and I first understood this when I was asking people in Bangladesh, you know, who was the first person that came in here and taught Islam? And invariably, the answer was it was a person who taught agriculture, the plow, rice cultivation, the cutting of the jungle. And it occurred to me that there's a very important interaction here between religion and the material base. Now, another problem is that scholars are kind of put in different silos. Religious studies is here, agriculture is here, the agricultural school, the fine arts are here in the fine arts schools, and in all academic institutions of which I'm aware, we have these different departments, and many of them don't talk to each other. So to come up with an idea that embraces agriculture and religion is literally talking on two ends of a campus. What we need to do, it seems to me, is integrate disciplines that appear to be very unrelated to each other, but in fact are very closely related to each other. And that is the challenge to me of scholarship today.
You know, I was telling Richard yesterday that we could have had about a 3-hour discussion with him because the range of his scholarship, and as well as the new ideas that he's been birthing with his scholarship are so many. But I'm going to sort of leave one question with you, which we'll address later before I call Madani Sahab, which is that you also write in your books about the fact that there were many local Islams which were, you know, very rooted in the local culture. But as modernity came and one had access to radio and to steamboat and the journeys to Mecca,
yes,
that post facto, a modern construct has been put onto Islam, which does homogenize it, make it a bit more monolithic, and in a more disturbing way, makes it centered in Arab culture rather than in these many indigenous local cultures with which it began. And that's something that I'd like to come back to you with after I invite Madani Sahab on stage. Mahmood Madani is the General Secretary of the Jamaat-e-Ulema-Hind. He's part of the conservative Deoband Seminary, which is extremely influential. It's important to remember that the Jamaat in 1947 voted against Pakistan and decided to stay back in India because they felt that Islam prohibited dividing countries and people on the basis of religion. Most recently, Madani Sahab has also been arguing that Indian Muslims should get over their historic fear of being second-class citizens, claim their rightful place, jobs, representation, reservation if necessary. And also at a very vitiated time, the Deoband Seminary put out a fatwa against terrorism. A train was taken from Deoband to Hyderabad, which had 6,000 clerics in it. I was one of the only women on that train, and it was one of the most fascinating rides I've ever had, most fascinating conversations. And I'm extremely pleased to have Madani Sahab here with us. Do welcome him. Madani Sahab and I have made a pact that I'm going to ask him questions in English and he's going to answer in Hindi. We did discuss a little bit about what we wanted to speak about, and so there are going to be some translation plates on the screen. It's not exactly synchronized with what Madani Sahab might say on stage, but for those of you who don't understand Hindi, it'll give you the gist of what it is that he wants to speak to us about. So Madani Sahab, to come back to that question I asked you when we last spoke, that in 1947, you decided to stay back, your community decided to stay back in India. Looking at the Satcher Committee report now, looking at the plight of Indian Muslims in India, in modern India, do you feel that in many ways the Indian state has betrayed you?
देखिए इसमें दो बातें हैं. अगर आप in general देखेंगे, तो सिर्फ मुसलमान की बात नहीं, बल्कि कंट्री ने जहाँ होना था वहाँ नहीं पहुँची. 90 करोड़ से ज़्यादा लोग अभी ऐसे हैं कि उनके लिए फूड सिक्योरिटी इंश्योर करने की ज़रूरत महसूस की जा रही है आज की तारीख में, इतने दिनों के बाद. तो सवाल यहाँ सिर्फ मुसलमान का नहीं है, सभी लोग, बहुत सारे लोग ऐसे हैं जो तकलीफ़ में. अब आप मुसलमान की बात अगर करें तो मैं इसमें दो बातें कहना चाहता हूँ. सिस्टमेटिकली टारगेट करके मुसलमान को हरेसमेंट हुआ है दोनों तरफ से, और कई तरह की तकलीफ़ों में डिस्क्रिमिनेशन है, फला है फला, ये सारी शिकायतें हैं जो जायज़ हैं. लेकिन इसके साथ एक ज़रूरी बात मेंशन करनी चाहता हूँ मैं यहाँ, वो ये है कि इस पूरे इंडियन सब कॉन्टिनेंट में, अफ़गानिस्तान से लेकर और बांग्लादेश, ये सारे इस एरिया को अगर इंक्लूड कर लें, तो मोर देन 50% नहीं तो अबाउट 50% मुसलमान सिर्फ इंडिया में हैं. और अगर आप कंपेयर करेंगे तो इस पूरे इंडियन सब कॉन्टिनेंट में किसी एरिया का मुसलमान इतने अच्छे हाल में नहीं है जितने अच्छे हाल में आज इंडिया का मुसलमान है, विद ऑल प्रॉब्लम्स. انجسٹس ہے, فلاں ہے, فلاں, ان سب کے ساتھ. تو آف کورس چیزوں کو ٹھیک کرنا ضروری ہے, ایکول اپورچونیٹی ضروری ہے, ایجوکیشن کے اوپر اسٹریس کرنا ضروری ہے, انصاف کے دوہرے پیمانوں کو بدلنا ضروری ہے, جو سب سے امپورٹنٹ ہے. یعنی اس صرف ایک آج کی سوسائٹی کے لیے نہیں, بلکہ جس انڈین سوسائٹی پر ہم لوگ فخر کرتے ہیں, گرو کرتے ہیں, ہمیں پراؤڈ ہے, اس کے لحاظ سے بھی اگر دیکھیں گے ہم, تو انصاف کے دوہرے معیار جو ہیں ان کو چینج کرنا ہوگا. ایک طرح کا انصاف ہونا چاہیے.
تو منی صاحب, آپ پہلے بھی یو سیڈ دیٹ اٹس ناٹ جسٹ اے کوشچن آف مسلمس, یو آر سیئنگ اٹ اگین دیٹ دا پروگرس آف مسلمس از انیکسٹریکبلی ٹائڈ ود دا پروگرس آف انڈیا, بیکاز یو آر یو نو دیر سچ اے لارج پرسینٹیج آف مسلمس ہیئر. And there are many ways in which the states and across parties that people have failed you, but is there also an occasion for Muslims to look within their own community to introspect, particularly the clerical maulanas, in ways in which Muslims have ghettoized themselves in this country? How would you respond to that?
Mushkil sawal hai, lekin baat ye hai ke آف کورس ہمیں خود بھی انٹروسپیکشن کرنا چاہیے, لیکن میں ایسا سمجھتا ہوں کہ حالات نے ایسا کر دیا. ابھی مظفر نگر میں جیسے آپ دیکھ رہی ہیں ہو رہا ہے, آسام میں ہوا, یہ ایک نیا ٹرینڈ ہوا ہے کہ ٹیررائز کر کے ایسی سچویشن کریٹ کر دی جاتی ہے یا ہو جاتی ہے کہ لوگ مائگریٹ کرنے پر مجبور ہو جاتے ہیں. تو اب جب آدمی, سب سے پہلی چیز تو آدمی کے لیے سیفٹی ہوتی ہے, اور آدمی اپنا آپ کو انسیف فیل کرے تو دوسرے ساری چیزیں پیچھے چلی جاتی ہیں. پہلے تو آدمی دیکھتا بھائی جان ہے تو جہان ہے, ادروائز تو کچھ بھی نہیں ہے. تو یہ ایک طرح کے حالات جو بنائے جاتے ہیں ان کا بڑا ریزن ہے. آف کورس کمیونٹی کی بھی کچھ نکلیں گی, اگر آپ ڈھونڈیں گے اس کو, ڈیپ میں جائیں گے تو فلا 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 ایکشن لے کر کے اس گھیٹوائزیشن سے بچا جا سکتا تھا, لیکن پہلی چیز سیکورٹی ہے, موسٹ امپورٹنٹ چیز.
کنیکٹڈ ود دس از دا ایشو آف ویمن ود ان دا مسلم کمیونٹی. آئی نو آئی ایم ناٹ پارٹ آف دیٹ آرگیومنٹ وچ سیز مسلمس آر مور oppressive to women than Hindu society is, but that is a kind of common perception of Islam, that it is oppressive to women. Any benchmark of a healthy society is of how it treats its women. Do you think to be modern, to take the place that you are arguing that Indian Muslims should become confident citizens of any country, not just India, that the position of women within Islam has to change?
Sorry, main aapka
کہ مہیلاؤں کی جو استھتی ہے مسلم قوم کے اندر, ان کا حالات بدلنی چاہیے کہ نہیں, جو پرانی سوچ ہے وہ بدلنی چاہیے کہ نہیں؟
یقیناً پرانی سوچ تو بدلنی چاہیے, لیکن اس پرانی سوچ کو بدلنے کے لیے جو کام آج کے اس ماڈرن ورلڈ میں ہو رہے ہیں, ہم ایسا سمجھتے ہیں کہ اگر اس کو پروگریس اور مہیلاؤں کی آزادی سمجھا جائے تو میں سمجھتا ہوں یہ غلط ہے. آف کورس حقوق ملنے چاہیے, برابری ہونی چاہیے, جو ہماری سوسائٹی میں, انڈین سوسائٹی میں پلائٹ ہے, ناانصافی ہے عورتوں کے ساتھ, نابرابری ہے, اس کو ختم ہونا چاہیے. اور ایون مسلمانوں میں بھی اسلام نے, دیکھیے آپ جو باتیں بہت ہی امپورٹنٹ چل رہا تھے, پورا وقت تو آپ کے ریچرڈ کے ساتھ ہونا چاہیے تھا, میں تو بلا وجہ بیچ میں آیا ہوں. آج کی تاریخ میں اسلام الگ چیز ہے, مسلمان الگ چیز ہے. انڈین سوسائٹی میں جو برائیاں تھیں اسلام مسلمانوں نے اس کو ٹھیک نہیں کیا اور خود مسلمان بھی افیکٹڈ ہیں, جیسے سماجی نابرابری. یہ یہاں کی سوسائٹی کا ایک حصہ تھا, الگ الگ حصوں میں بانٹ رکھا تھا انسانوں کو. تو اسلام نے تو سب انسانوں کو برابر قدر جا دیا ہے, لیکن مسلمان آج بھی پریکٹیکلی اس جگہ پہ نہیں ہے. ایسے ہی عورتوں کے معاملے میں بھی جو درجہ اسلام نے عورتوں کو دیا ہے, مسلمانوں کی سوسائٹی کا ایک بڑا حصہ وہ درجہ نہیں دیتا, بلکہ اسی چیز کو فالو کرتا ہے جو سماجی برائی آئی ہوئی ہمارے اندر. جہیز کا معاملہ ہے, فلاں ہے, فلاں ہے, یہ ساری چیزیں جو اس سوسائٹی سے ہم کو ملی ہیں اسی کو پر چل رہا ہے. اسلام کو کہاں فالو کرتا ہے مسلمان؟
تو مدنی صاحب, I'm just going to come back to that same question. I'm going to pose it to مدنی صاحب first. دو چیزیں اس میں مدنی صاحب. ون, آئی آسکڈ یو دیٹ اسلام ان انڈیا ہیز اے ڈفرنٹ کائنڈ آف کلچر دین اسلام ان دا مڈل ایسٹ. وائی از دیٹ؟ یو نو دا ہندو رائٹ آفن آرگیوز دیٹ اٹس ناٹ دیر آرگیومنٹ از ناٹ دیٹ مسلم شوڈ ورشپ اندر گاڈ اور اندر ریلیجن, but that they don't acknowledge the Indianness of the culture of Indian Muslims, but are trying to import Arabic culture onto Indian Muslims. How would you respond to that?
Dekhiye, Arabic culture bhi jo hai wo culture hai, Islam nahi hai. Aur Islam jo Musliman India mein dikhte hain wo bhi Musliman 100% اسلام کے فالوور نہیں ہیں. لیکن اگر اسلام کے نیئرسٹ پوری دنیا کی کوئی سوسائٹی ہے تو وہ انڈیا کی سوسائٹی ہے, انڈین مسلمس کی. عربوں کی سوسائٹی اسلام کے نیئرسٹ نہیں. انہوں نے اپنے کلچر کو, جیسے یہاں بھی کلچر نے ہمارے اندر بہت ساری چیزیں ایسی رکھی ہوئی ہیں جو اسلامک نہیں ہیں, ان اسلامک چیزیں, ہماری عادتیں پڑی ہوئی ہیں ویسے, ویسی ان کی بھی ہیں. اور انہوں نے اپنا پولیٹیکل مقصد سے اس کا ایک انٹرپریٹیشن کیا ہوا ہے جس کو وہ اسلام کے نام سے دنیا کے سامنے پیش کرتے ہیں, پروستے ہیں. تو میں یہ سمجھتا ہوں کہ انڈیا کا جو اسلام ہے وہ نیئرسٹ ہے اسلام کے, حالانکہ یہاں بھی بہت ساری کمی ہے. تو ہمیں وہاں سے کوئی چیز لانے کی ضرورت نہیں, اور اگر وہاں سے کوئی انفلوئنس آتا ہے تو وہ صحیح انٹرپریٹیشن نہیں ہے, غلط انٹرپریٹیشن ہے, اور اس سے اسلام کی تصویر بگڑتی ہے, بنتی نہیں ہے.
آئی آسکڈ یو اباؤٹ وہابزم, دا فیکٹ دیٹ دیر از اے لاٹ آف کنسرن ان انڈیا دیٹ دا پلورل ٹالرنٹ ویری ملٹی فیسٹڈ نیچر آف اسلام ان انڈیا از ناؤ بینگ ڈسپلیسڈ بائی دا انکمنگ آف وہابزم ان ٹو انڈیا. Why are Muslims in India embracing Wahhabism so much? What does the Deoband Seminary feel about it?
Dekhiye, hum log Islam ka jo interpretation Deoband ne kiya hai, wo interpretation, ab hum to kyunki Deoband se belong karte hain to hum to yahi kahenge ki wo sahi hai. Jis tarah ka interpretation unhone kiya hai, ایک اچھی پلورلسٹک سوسائٹی کے لیے وہ انٹرپریٹیشن کبھی بھی صحیح رول پلے نہیں کر سکتا. وہ ایک, انہوں نے اپنی پولیٹیکل حالات اور اپنے کلچر کے ساتھ مکس کر کے ایک انٹرپریٹیشن کیا ہے. ہمارے جو فور فادر تھے یا دیوبند کے جو فاؤنڈرس تھے, انہوں نے اسلام کو سمجھ کر اور اس ملٹی کلچرل سوسائٹی کے لیے جو صحیح انٹرپریٹیشن اسلام کا ہو سکتا تھا, دیکھیے اسلام کا بیس جو ہے وہ ٹولرنٹ پر ہے, ٹولرنٹ پر ہے, برداشت پر ہے, صبر پر ہے. اور لوگ جس طرح ری ایکٹ کرتے ہیں وہ بالکل بے صبری کا ہے, इंटॉलरेंस का है, बर्दाश्त ही नहीं कर सकते हम, आपकी बात भी बर्दाश्त नहीं की जा सकती, एक तो बड़ी बात है। तो हमें जो इस्लाम मिला है विरासत में, वो तो वही इस्लाम मिला है जिसने बर्दाश्त सिखाया, और आज दुनिया को इसी जो सही इस्लाम है उसकी ज़रूरत है। इस्लाम के बारे में जो दूसरे लोग कहते हैं उसका नुकसान इस्लाम को होता है, लेकिन उससे ज़्यादा इस्लाम को नुकसान हमारे एक्शन से होता है। तो हमें अपने आप को ठीक करना होगा, और ये जो बाहर से जो इंटरप्रिटेशन इस्लाम की आ रही है इसको एक्सेप्ट नहीं किया जा सकता कभी भी इस मुल्क में।
In fact, when I spoke to Madni Sahab earlier and I had asked him this question about Wahhabism, he said the Wahhabis look at both Deobandi Muslims and many of the facets of Islam in India as more alien perhaps than even Hindus, you know, and that there is such a distinction between their interpretation of Islam and gratifyingly the interpretation of Islam in India. So Richard, I want to come back to that question I asked you.
Yeah.
That so what happened in modernity, you know, you've been talking about the many plural ways in which Islam took root in India.
Yes.
So what happened when the steamboat came and the radio came? Why did Muslims begin to see themselves as a homogeneous community?
Yes. Well, the word modernity I guess use it this one. Yeah, the word modernity is another one of these problematic terms to me. You know, modernity to me simply connotes increasing interconnectedness across the planet. And this is not something which began in the year 1800 or 1760 necessarily. We can see in the past, you know, a continuing need to, or continuing fact of interconnectedness and relatedness occurring. And with respect to Islam, of course, there's no doubt that the Hajj, the pilgrimage to Mecca, became a central institution, especially after the Mongols sacked Baghdad in the 13th century. And we see a gradual increasing of the making of the Hajj. You mentioned the steamboat, of course, that radically increased that in the 19th century as well. So yes, there is a certain sense in which modernity, at least with respect to technology, did facilitate a greater communication, making it possible for more and more Muslims throughout the world to visualize Islam as it was practiced in Mecca and Medina, in the heartland. And then when they go back to their homes, oftentimes they see a greater divergence between what they had experienced in Arabia and what they are now seeing in their home villages. And so that the status of the Haji becomes a very, very pronounced phenomenon in the 19th and 20th century. And there's no question that the standardization of many rituals and customs and rites does occur as a consequence of that kind of technology. But I would insist that this is nothing that radically began in the 19th century, that it had been a long prior history of such tightening up of understandings between the periphery and the heartland.
Madni Sahab, there's one question that the whole audience will want to hear from you. That recently when you've been criticizing the secular left, the Congress, the Samajwadi Party, there is an automatic assumption that you've become a defender or an admirer of Narendra Modi. How would you respond to that question?
देखिए, एक बात तो ये है कि जो सो कॉल्ड सेकुलर पॉलिटिकल पार्टीज़ हैं हमारे देश की, वो सेकुलर होने में उनका कोई कमाल नहीं है। वो सेकुलर दिखती हैं, सेकुलर जैसा सेकुलर यकीन होना चाहिए वैसा नहीं है। बाज़ार में जो चीज़ जिस वक्त बिक सकती है उसके हिसाब से बेचते हैं। आज मैं पूरे कॉन्फिडेंस के साथ कहता हूं, अगर सेकुलरिज्म इस मुल्क में है तो किसी पॉलिटिकल पार्टी की वजह से नहीं है, बल्कि इस सोसाइटी की वजह से है। ये सोसाइटी सेकुलर है, اب یہ ضرورت پڑنے پہ سیکولرزم کا برقع اوڑھ لیں اور چاہے مودی صاحب اڑا لیں خرید خرید کے مارکیٹ سے. اب اگر اس کو ٹوک دیں گے آپ تو بجائے اس کے کہ ایشو کو دیکھا جائے اور جو ایشو ریز کیا جا رہا ہے اس کو نظر ڈالی جائے آدمی کو ایلیمینیٹ کرنے کے لیے غلط مقصد سے یہ پروپیگنڈا کر دیا جائے کہ یہ تو مودی پریمی ہو گئے. اگر ہم بس ان کو کچھ نہ کہیں اور اگر ان کو کچھ کہہ دیں گے تو ساری برائیاں ہمارے اندر آ جائیں گے. تو اس کا سچائی سے تو کوئی تعلق نہیں ہے. البتہ ان کو ٹوکا نہ جائے, ان کو کہا نہ جائے, بس یہی بات ہے اتنی سی.
دس از اے کانورسیشن دیٹ کین گو آن اینڈلیسلی. ٹو میری دیٹ سویپ آف ہسٹری وتھ اٹس امپیکٹس ان کنٹمپرری انڈیا از ڈیفیکلٹ ٹو ڈو ان اے ٹائم اسپین آف 35 منٹس. بٹ فور می بوتھ میٹنگ رچرڈ ایٹن اینڈ محمود مدنی has been particularly fascinating because both of them challenge the kind of very superficial but extremely passionate notions with which we live and by which we condemn and judge those around us, and in fact add to the kind of fractious nature of contemporary conversations in India. The thing that I took away most from Richard was this idea that history needs to be unraveled rather than merely read. We often take what we read in books as absolute truths, and it requires fresher and fresher scholarships for us to understand that in different ways. The one conversation we didn't even begin to touch on with him was this idea of looking at history through the prism of literatures of Sanskrit and Persian rather than through Hinduism and Islam, and I think that would have yielded even richer benefits. And Madni sahab, of course, by being the stereotype of Muslims that people fear and think of as being extremely conservative, has always been for me a refreshing point of conversation because he's so self-confident about being who he is and of claiming for his community and himself their rightful place in this extremely rainbow nation of ours. Thank you so much for listening.
Thank you. Thank you.